Let us stand and worship our God. O Lord, who may abide in your tent? Who may dwell on your holy hill? Those who do not slander with their tongue and do no evil to their friends. Let us worship God. Continue to worship in our litany of confession. When the cross appears as folly instead of God's power. When some demand signs and others seek wisdom. When the favor of the world claim the favor of God. We despise the weak and long to be strong. We despise the ignorant and seek to be wise.
Christ's foolishness is wisdom, Christ's weakness is strength.
We despise the lowly and struggle for status.
Christ's foolishness is wisdom, Christ's weakness is strength.
Know this first of all, if we confess our sin to Almighty God, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin in Jesus' name, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Praise God. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven.
Thank you.
Let us share this moment in prayer. O Lord God, we thank you that you have called us to be your people and to serve your purpose. We ask you to surround and encourage with love and strength and guidance those who are called to this day to be leaders in our church, servants in leading us to be the people we're called to be. We're a people who are grateful for one another and surround each other with our love. And we pray for your encouragement and your healing for those whose hearts are wounded, for Michelle and John, for Veronica and Mickey and Bob. Lord, we pray for them, that they know your strength and your healing from their grief. We pray for those who are hospitalized, for Georgie and the long time that she has been there. Lord, we pray for those who lead our worship. We pray for the people in this church who serve you in leadership roles, and for those who are called to tasks of ministry beyond our doorstep. We ask you, O Lord, to let the light that you've given us shine through us in all that we do and all that we seek to be. So, Lord, we thank you that you're here with us, that you're embracing us even in this moment, that you're encouraging us and guiding us and directing our path and sending us out into the world with the strength of your Spirit to be your people. And so we pray together as Jesus taught us to pray to you, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We are privileged to be his people in this world and to serve his purpose. So let us give of ourselves, of our tithes and our morning offerings, that we might reach out into the community that surrounds us and be his people in service. Let us worship God with our tithes and morning offerings.
Thank you.
we stand here to dedicate ourselves anew to be your people in this place and to serve you with all that we have and all that we give and all that we are. We ask you to lead us forth that we might be a shining light to this community and to all who surround our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, thank you for braving South Florida's one day of winter to be here this morning. I always get somebody, and I don't know why this is, but after we do it, says, when is Scottish Sunday? They want to know when there's going to be bagpipes here. And so in 2 weeks, we have Scottish Sunday. Okay, so you can freshen up your kilt or whatever you need to do before then, but we want you to know that that's there. We have two readings this morning. One is a gospel reading from Matthew 5, 1 through 12, and the other is an epistle reading, 1 Corinthians 1, 18 through 31. And we encourage you to read along in your Bible. But before we read those together, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come into this space hoping to get a glimpse of the wonder and awe that is you. And so I pray this morning, Lord, that from my mouth to the listener's ears, you would transform my words so that they would be yours and yours alone. Send your Holy Spirit among us, Lord, and help us to hear your call upon our lives. We love you and we need you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Matthew 5, 1 through 12. Hear the word of the Lord. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." And then 1 Corinthians 1, 18 through 31, the words of Paul. "For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, 'I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart.' Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of the age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. So this morning, I'm going to describe three pretty different scenarios and see if you can deduce a common thread between the three. Understand? Ready? Scenario one. This happened about 2 weeks ago. My son was sleeping in between my wife and I, and in the middle of the night, he quickly awoke and Chef Boyardee barfaronied all over our bed. Being only 22 months old and a little shocked, he looked at me, and then he looked at his mother and said, "Yuck." Scenario two. More years ago than I want to count now, I remember my first junior high dance. It was 2 months into seventh grade and was Halloween themed. And thankfully, I don't know what middle school dances are like now, but back in those days, they were uncomfortably awkward. And I was also like 12 and in a pretty sad vampire costume, so that didn't help either. But some of you may remember that back in the 1980s, all you needed to have to throw a junior high dance was a gymnasium with one row of chairs on one side for the boys and another row of chairs on the other side for the girls, and a high school DJ with questionable tastes in music. And on that note, I distinctly remember hearing for the very first time in my life the rock band Guns N' Roses, their song Welcome to the Jungle being played. Now remember, my whole seventh grade class has only been in a completely new school for 2 months. And then in that distinct Axl Rose screeching voice, we all hear together, "You're in the jungle, baby, you're going to die." And at that moment, at 12, my plastic vampire teeth almost fell out of my mouth. And I specifically remember thinking, "Wait, who is chaperoning us?" Then scenario three, very simple. We were here not too long ago, so picture this in your mind. All of the antics of the 2016 presidential election. So what are these three things? A vomiting child, an awkward junior high dance with tasteless lyrics, and our 2016 presidential candidates have in common? Maybe more than we'd like to admit. But for the purposes of this morning, I'd like to suggest that they all invoke the yuck factor. Now, what is the yuck factor? Well, back in the late 1990s, Leon Cass, who is a biologist at the University of Chicago, who would later then serve as chair for the President's Council on Bioethics, he coined the term the wisdom of repugnance, aka the yuck factor. And Cass's argument about the yuck factor basically refers to the notion that wisdom may lead to a feeling of disgust towards anything that lacks goodness, even though you might not be able to explain logically why you feel disgust. So if we are truly wise, then, when something isn't right or it's somehow off or it's simply an injustice or even outright evil, then according to the yuck factor, it will repulse us, even if we don't have the words to describe why. It kind of reminds me of the couple that decided that they needed to take up a new hobby so that they could strengthen their marriage. Have you heard about this? They decided they'd take up duck hunting. And they had heard of other people going duck hunting with dogs, so they figured they needed to buy a good hunting dog, and so a good hunting dog they did buy. They got all of their equipment and their dog, and they took off to go duck hunting for the day. And they tried to get some ducks, but they came to the end of the day and they hadn't gotten a single one. And the husband looked to his wife and said, "Honey, we've got to be doing something wrong here. We haven't caught a duck yet." And the wife said, "Well, maybe if we throw the dog up a little higher, he can catch a duck this time." That's a ridiculous story, but it's kind of what the Apostle Paul is telling the Christian Corinthians in our epistle today. You might want to consider if you're doing things right. Corinth actually wasn't that different from modern day South Florida. It was a coastal town where folks were focused on wealth and power and a party lifestyle. And if you were an average person who lived in Corinth, the wisdom of the world implied that you should engage in activities that result in your acquisition of more money, more power, and more pleasure. And so it was typical for the Corinthian elites, according to worldly wisdom, to articulate their repugnance towards the poor and the powerless and the disenfranchised. But Paul is quick to say, this is not the wisdom of God. Humanity's identity is found in Jesus Christ alone, and Jesus teaches us something radically different. And for Paul, understanding the difference between the wisdom of God and the wisdom of the world begins with understanding Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection. You see, before the resurrection, death was perceived to be the ultimate weapon against humanity. The threat of death could control or curtail our ability to act against injustice. Crucifixion was the Roman Empire's very public way of saying, we're in control, and if you object, we will take everything from you, including your very life. And so when Jesus goes to the cross, all of that anti-God cosmic idolatry seems to be winning. The wisdom of the world seems to be winning. Might makes right. But what the powers of the world didn't realize is that when Jesus went to the cross, he was about to set us all free. And the proclamation of that freedom comes 3 days later when he is resurrected. Because in the resurrection is proof that Jesus, aka God, has the power over death. And Christ's promise is that if we follow Jesus, we will have life also. In other words, there is now nothing in the world that can ultimately stop you from doing the right thing. And you don't have to be held hostage from a fear of dying, because Jesus has the power to help you overcome death. Now, to be clear, that doesn't mean that we can't and won't still experience suffering. It just means that no one can ultimately keep you from doing what is right in Christ. And that's because, as a Christian, the world now has no authentic power over you. If you don't have an allegiance to money, the world can take your job, but it can't keep you from doing what is right. If you don't have any allegiance to power, then the world can strip you of titles, but it can't keep you from doing what is right. If you don't let pleasure become an idol for you, moreover, if you lose your allegiance to being comfortable, then you may indeed suffer, but the world can't keep you from doing what is right. You see, because of Christ, the only power that the world can have over you is the power that you freely give it. Hear that again. Because of Christ, the only power that the world can have over you is the power that you freely give it. The powers of this world, they can't even murder you. to keep you from doing what is right, because you have victory over death in Jesus. You and I, we are truly free in Christ. And so Paul is saying, we need the wisdom of God, because if we are living by the wisdom of the world, then our priorities are wrong. And if we are appealing to the yuck factor using the wisdom of the world, then that feeling is likely rooted in the worldly evils of racism or misogyny or elitism or injustice, or you fill in the blank. Instead, the wisdom of God that Jesus teaches us is blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, it's right behavior, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, right behavior's sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says, rejoice and be glad, because the world ultimately has no power over you if you can learn to be like this. Now, this is a really important point. Living a life in Christ is not just about doing the right things. It's not just about doing the right things. It is actually about becoming and being a new God-reflecting way. But becoming the type of people who are peacemakers, gentle and patient, merciful, pure in heart, people who hunger and thirst for right behavior, this doesn't happen overnight. It takes practice. It takes encouragement. It takes the support of Christians around us to be better. And that process of formation, that process of developing character and becoming virtuous, requires each of us to make moment by moment decisions to choose the way of Jesus until it becomes what Paul calls our second nature. It requires continuous effort and intentionality to go from trying to be something to actually becoming it. And if we think about this, even for just a moment, we quickly see that the world is not trying to help us with this. Actually, it is encouraging the exact opposite. Let me give you a common example in family ministries. I often hear the phrase, boys will be boys, essentially expressing the view that mischievous or bad behavior is typical of boys or even grown men. But that is just nonsense. That's nonsense. Beyond that, it's just poor parenting. Boys and men, as well as girls and women, will behave how we nurture them or fail to nurture them. And if we don't take the time to nurture one another and to walk with one another and learning to act like and ultimately become like Christ, then yes, boys and men and girls and women alike will act badly. But now that Jesus has been resurrected, nothing can ultimately stop us from choosing the ways of Christ. Within the first few months that I began serving here at First Pres, I went on the Lake Placid family retreat. And Janelle and I had just had Paxson, and so I drove up late the first night. And when I arrived, many of the parents were standing around the bonfire talking. And while the parents were chatting, their kids were running around all over the place having a good old time. But after a while, my pastor antenna kind of went up when a little group of boys started getting a little too Lord of the Fly-ish off in the distance. And so I went over to see what they were up to. And when I got over there, I discovered that because we were close to a lake, there were toads everywhere hopping around. And these little boys, I don't remember specifically who they were, but these little boys, they decided that it would be a good idea to start throwing toads at one another. So being a bit unsettled by this, I went over and was like, hey, you toad tosser, stop. And right away, they knew what they were doing was inappropriate. They totally knew. So they started passing blame on one another. Well, I didn't throw one. He did. I just laughed. Well, then I said, don't do that. And one of them very quickly, almost defiantly said, well, why not? Now, this is a good lesson for all of us. Because if we openly recognize that we have the yuck factor about something, and someone asks us why we are asking him or her to change their ways, we are quickly in danger of looking hypocritical if we haven't thought things through. And this is part of why we need to continually be engaged in study and reflection about God's word so that we can nurture others based on God's wisdom as opposed to the world's. So I said very plainly to the boy, because God made those toads, and he made all of you to protect and to care for them. And so it's okay to look at them. They're awesome. Look at them, but take care of them. And all of those boys shook their head in agreement, and their disposition completely changed, I mean, dramatically, right there. And they started looking at and admiring these creatures that God had made. And this is the difference in walking in the way that Christ calls us to. When we follow the wisdom of God, we start living into a version of ourselves that is more fully human, as we are intended to be by our Creator. We become the faithful stewards of our world that want the best for people and creation. And then when we experience the yuck factor via God's wisdom, we know that that is God prompting us to continue to explore further what it means to be like Christ and to bring forth a world that is on earth as it is in heaven. But again, this takes time. It means choosing to make the decision of Christ at every opportunity, every week, every day, every hour, every minute, every second. Choose Jesus, and you will be blessed. So I've said this before. How do you climb a mountain? One step at a time. How do you eat an elephant? You don't. They're endangered. It's illegal. I mean, come on, yuck factor, right? But there's good news. If we continue to be formed in the virtuous teachings of Jesus, over time, we will become the instruments in bringing forth the kingdom of God, a kingdom where we don't get sick, where we don't worry about being safe or about dying, where all aims, political and otherwise, are directed at stewarding humanity and the world in a way that glorifies God. Those are the people we are called to be. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, as we prepare to gather together in this space, Lord, we seek your wisdom and your wisdom alone. You have called us to be image bearers and to be stewards of your kingdom. And Lord, we pray that we would live into that role here and now, Lord. So we ask for your Holy Spirit to be among us, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask that we call our meeting to order, and at the beginning of the meeting, I'm going to ask that we split the house. And what that means is if you are a member, only members, not affiliate members or visitors, if you are a member, I'm going to ask you to sit in this section right here. We'll give you a couple minutes to transition. And once folks are seated, then I'm going to make sure the ushers pass out the annual reports to you.